Significant differences when it comes to Syria, when it comes to the Iran nuclear deal, when trade issues. Lots to discuss right now. We want to welcome our viewers once again here in the United States and around the world. I'm Wolf Blitzer in Washington. And let's get to all those national security issues, Gloria Borger. But the president did make some news about his nominee to become Secretary of Veterans Affairs, Dr. Ronnie Jackson, the personal physician of the president in the White House. He's been the physician there through the Obama administration, now the Trump administration. The president said, if I were him, I wouldn't do it. He basically was telling him, it's your decision, but maybe you want to drop out of this nomination process.
Right. I mean, look, it's clear he has a great personal affection for him, but he gave him the out. And without saying goodbye, he said, look, I told him I wouldn't do it. And why do you want this for? You've got a great family. You've got a great life. You're a great doctor. Why do you want to deal with these Democrats? He said, it's his choice. But if I were him, I wouldn't do it. I wouldn't be abused by a bunch of politicians. So clearly they've had a conversation. And the president said to him, your decision, but if I were you, don't do it, which, you know, reading between the lines means the president understands that there are real problems there.
Yeah. If the president said he never heard of any of these allegations against Dr. Ronnie Jackson.
He wasn't vetted.
Yeah.
Okay.
But now he's, since the nomination, he's been vetted. Jeff Zeleny, you're over there in the East Room at the White House just watching this news conference. What did you think?
Well, there is no question that President Trump opened the door for his personal doctor, Dr. Ronnie Jackson, to make a decision and potentially step down from his nomination at the Veterans Affairs Department. This is the strongest words we have heard from the White House, from the president indeed. Just a few hours ago, of course, the White House released a statement giving his full credentials, saying that they were not going to withdraw his nomination. But the president certainly, while saying it was his decision, essentially offered him a permission slip, if you will, to step away. As Gloria was just saying, what is the need to go through this ugly process? So the president was giving him a soft landing. I would be surprised, Wolf, if at the end of the day, perhaps even the end of the afternoon, if Dr. Jackson would still be in the running for the VA secretary. Important to point out, Republicans, senators asking questions, as well as Democratic senators. Senator Johnny Isaacson, Republican of Georgia, the chairman of the Veterans Affairs Committee, also sending a letter to the president with his Democratic counterpart, asking for more information. The hearing was scheduled to be tomorrow. So that, of course, is the domestic headline out of this, Wolf, but also important to point out a new potential Iran nuclear deal, not to replace the existing one, perhaps, but perhaps a supplemental one that also could give the U.S. some wiggle room here for the president when he has to make a decision by May 12th to essentially withdraw or not. So clearly, it seemed to me that there was a much softer language. The president earlier today called it insane. We did not hear that language from here, him here in the East Room, Wolf. So clearly trying to broker a deal that could perhaps be a win-win that would allow the president to declare victory by getting a stronger deal, in his words, a more solid deal. Keep in mind, this was negotiated under the Obama administration. President Obama and his Secretary of State, John Kerry, negotiated this. The president has not liked it from the very beginning. So clearly a new deal could be more of a Trump deal. We'll see if that happens. Also, Wolf, one final thought. Syria, the president also saying, I want to come home, wants to bring the troops home, did not say exactly a time frame on that, as well as talking about North Korea still going forward with the idea of a summit in June. But again, the president making the point he made last week at Mar-a-Lago, meeting with Japanese Prime Minister Shinzo Abe, that he would walk away from a summit, walk away from a deal, if they could not broker something. And he said in the most explicit terms yet, Wolf, asked directly about what his definition of denuclearization was, he said this, it makes, it means they get rid of the nukes. So quite blunt there, it means they get rid of the nukes. We'll see if that happens after the meeting. So quite a bit of news in this meeting, in this press conference here, Wolf, in the East Room. Now the president is going on to meet with his defense secretary and, of course, that big state dinner tonight here at the White House. Wolf.
And tomorrow, President Macron will address a joint meeting of the United States Congress. Jim Sciutto, the deal that President Macron put forward is to keep the Iran nuclear deal in place, prevent Iran at least until 2025 from getting nuclear weapons, but then to expand it. He wants a new deal with Iran, no nuclear weapons for Iran ever, long range, end their ballistic missile program, which threatens the region, and end their involvement in Yemen, Syria, and Lebanon. Now, that's the proposal that President Macron put forward. Why would the Iranians accept a new deal?
Well, that's a fair question, because this may be more about managing the president's expectations about this deal and addressing the president's concerns than, and Robin has made this point as well, creating a new agreement. You know, his key criticisms and other criticisms of this deal have been it's got a sunset clause. It ends after a certain amount of time. It does not address their ballistic missile program, and it doesn't address their other destabilizing activities in the region, in Syria and elsewhere. Macron laying that out as part of the four pillars, as he called it, trying to find a structure that satisfies the president's concerns there. Now, the question is, if China, Russia, Iran, if they're not actually at the table, this is agreement between the U.S. and its European partners there, what is the actual accountability of that deal? And is it more about giving the president the ability to say, I improved a deal I always criticized, as opposed to renegotiating the deal? It's a fair question. We don't know. But I will say, and I think we should note this, and Jeff made a similar point. This morning, the president sat next to the French president, who supports staying in the Iran nuclear deal, called it insane, ridiculous. And his language here, the president saying, we have a great shot at a new agreement, saying at the end, remarkably as well, that in life you need to show flexibility. Leaders as countries need to show flexibility. Interesting words to hear from President Trump's mouth on this issue. And for Macron to have climbed that mountain, if he has indeed brought the president back into the fold on this deal, that'd be a pretty remarkable diplomatic move.
Robin Wright is with us as well. She's done a lot of reporting on Iran. You recently met with the foreign minister of Iran as well. The president says, no one knows what I will do on May 12th. That's the date he has to decide whether to keep the Iran deal. If the Iranians do go forward and reestablish their nuclear program, he says they will pay a price like few countries have ever paid, suggesting rather bluntly the U.S. will attack.
Oh, I think that's quite clear. I think his language this morning was incredibly tough, but I think it's also, he's in the middle of a week of intense diplomacy by the Europeans. You have President Macron today, you have Angela Merkel from Germany on Friday, and the British Prime Minister is also going to be having a telephone conversation on just this supplemental deal. It's not a new deal. It is an interpretation by the three European powers and the United States about these key issues, about how long does this nuclear deal last? And they're basically saying it will be indefinite, permanent. They deal with the issue of Iran's meddling in the region, its intercontinental ballistic missiles. But they are not looking to change the deal. They're not looking to get buy-in from Russia and China, which are also signatories to the deal. And there's no enforcement mechanism. It is basically a document setting out what their goals are, what their interpretation is, and what their common agenda is in dealing with Iran in the region. So the question is, are the Iranians going to buy it? And when I talked with the Iranian foreign minister, he said, in fact, the United States is the one that's in violation because it's impeding business, which was the one thing the Iran got out of the deal. The Iranians, as the United Nations Nuclear Weapons Agency has verified, have complied completely with the deal. And so they said they're not going to sign on to any new deal that requires more of them and doesn't get the United States to actually do what it's supposed to do. So this is a very interesting and innovative diplomatic approach to the Iran deal. The question is it going to work or make a difference, and are the Iranians going to buy in?
Well, what do you think? Are the Iranians going to buy what President Macron is proposing?
I think it's going to be a real tough sell. The fact is the Iranians will say to them, why should we do anything more when you're not complying with the basics?
Well, they did get a lot of money. They got $150 billion, and as the president keeps saying, almost $2 billion in cash.
Well, remember, this was all from a deal that had to do with military equipment that the Iranian government bought during the Shah's era. Right. So we actually owed them money. This was not a gift.
What do you think? You think the Iranians, AB, are going to buy this? And you think President Macron clearly supports it, but you think President Trump will support what President Macron is putting forward to avoid, in effect, a collapse of the Iran nuclear deal?
Right. Well, Robin's reporting actually really puts this in context. This is a make Trump feel great again ploy. essentially. It's semantics. We're going to layer on some amendment that's non-binding to make him feel good about recertification on May 12th, which he dreads doing. So he had some comments in the Oval Office this morning where he made sure to roar like a lion about it. Then he retreated at the press conference. It's always a roller coaster ride. TPP was a rape of our country, and 2 weeks ago, he was considering getting back in it. So Macron can't be guaranteed that this is something that Trump would even stick to through the next round of conference calls. I cannot see the regime agreeing to something that's where they believe they've been in compliance, as Robin reports, and that money that was given to them in the original deal was money that belonged to the regime. So if it's a masterstroke, if they bring the regime to the table and all of a sudden they get P5 plus one, every signatory back, but it's just hard to imagine that happening.
You know, just listening to Macron and listening to Robin talk about the president's schedule this week, you know, Angela Merkel, a phone call with the UK, it sounds like an intervention that they have planned, a literal intervention with Donald Trump.
Totally.
That they have organized and planned so that Macron starts, Merkel, because he's got the best relationship. Merkel, not so much. Not a great relationship, but she continues. He lays the groundwork. Then you have the phone calls. And it's just very clear to me that they have tried to figure out a way to circle the wagons around Donald Trump to get him back to a certain degree so that they can then go to Iran and say, okay, this is the best we're going to get because of Donald Trump. But I think they're trying to make him feel good about leading the process when, in fact, they're leading him to the process, and they're all doing it together.
And in doing so, echoing some of his words, Macron, even as he was describing those four pillars, he said, you know, these are things that the president has addressed, and addressing them even in the same language to give the impression, really, that they're on the same page about these priorities.
And his ability to work President Trump, clearly he made a point when he suggested that the previous administration, the Obama administration, didn't do what they were supposed to do when there were Syrian chemical weapons used and the U.S. did not cross that so-called red line. That's something that President Trump clearly was happy to hear. I want to get to North Korea in a moment, but on Syria, the president, or a few weeks ago, said the U.S. has got to get out very soon, get its troops out of Syria. He always makes the point that the $7 trillion, he says, the U.S. has spent in Iraq, Afghanistan, in Syria over these past years since 9/11, a total waste of money. It's awful. The U.S. needs to use that kind of money for infrastructure, bridges, highways, schools. But then he said that there are immensely wealthy countries, Jim, in the region. I think he's referring to Saudi Arabia, the Emiratis, Bahrain, other countries in the region, Qatar. They've got to come up with the cash, and they've got to come up with the troops to deal with Syria and other countries in the face of what he regards as Iranian aggression.
Well, and describing them, U.S. allies, in terms that I can't imagine they welcomed, saying, I forget his exact phraseology, but something like they would be nothing without us, right?
Right. Within a week, they'd be gone, he said.
They stand because we back them, and perhaps there's some truth in that, but is that language that you address your allies with? And not dissimilar from the way the president went after European allies regarding NATO funding, right? You know, saying that they're not putting up. And he claims credit now for having gotten NATO countries to pony up. So he might be looking at the Middle East and saying, listen, it worked there. They're going to have to pony up and put boots on the ground. And the truth, the president on this is on pretty solid ground here, right? I mean, for years, there have been a lot of countries in the region that have preferred to have U.S. boots on the ground rather than their own in some of these dangerous situations. Now, the question is he going to get what he wants? And also, knowing the you know, not just the Sunni-Shia rift, but many rifts in that country, is their participation militarily going to help the situation or make it worse?
Yeah, the problem is he wants to get out of Syria. At the same time, he doesn't want to give the Iranians access. And if the United States or the West withdraws, you know, there is that.
Well, he says he says these immensely wealthy countries, they must continue to, they must pay for it. The U.S., he says, will not continue to pay for it. They must pay for it, and they must put their soldiers on the ground. So, Robin, you know the region well. Are the Saudis, the Emiratis, the Qataris, the Bahrainis going to send troops to Syria?
No. The Egyptians might. There might be other countries they can recruit, the poor countries that are dependent, and they get the Saudis, you know, to foot the bill for deploying them there. I mean, it would involve a very complex mix. The problem is the Arab world has not been very good in the past about policing itself. When they've had Arab peacekeeping forces in Lebanon and elsewhere, you know, it is the situation has crumbled often rather quickly. And the danger is, what is it that you actually are trying to achieve in Syria? And with the president, that's not clear. As it now appears, he looks like he's willing to let President Assad stay in power until the next presidential election in Syria, which is 2021. The idea that you can get some kind of compromise worked out with the Arabs leading it, I think is, look at the Arabs. We're supporting different factions, different rebel groups. To get them to speak with one voice on Syria is going to be very difficult.
This is a major shift, though, I think, from mission accomplished to I want to have the troops home having accomplished what we should have accomplished. So I think you even see a softening there. And you know, this is a president who's changeable. Maybe he was doing it because he was standing next to Macron. I mean, we don't know. But it is a very different tone from the one we've been
And Macron, in some of his comments there, and maybe perhaps privately as well, seemed to be echoing what the president heard from his own military advisors after his promised withdrawal, saying, listen, it's too soon. We pull out now. We may be repeating the mistake of Obama withdrawing troops.
Clearly, AB, there's a significant difference as far as Syria, keeping U.S. troops in Syria, significant difference between President Macron and President Trump.
Right, but I think that President Trump has retreated upon the advice of his advisors in the days following his comments about withdrawal on this issue, particularly then enforced by the attack on chemical facilities in Syria and his sort of affirmation about how important that is and how the Russians and the Iranians are propping up the Assad regime. And he even named the Russians in a tweet. It was pretty, you know, emphatic and unique tweet for Donald Trump. So he's been talked into staying in Syria, and I think during this visit, he knew he had to answer those questions today. He doesn't want to talk about Syria because he's sending mixed messages, and I think he's retreated.
U.S.
He wants to make it all about the Iran deal, keep the focus on that, because I think people have talked him out of a retreat in
Syria.
U.S.,
by the way, has 2,200 troops in Syria right now. We'll see how long they stay. On North Korea, Jim, the president said, you know, we're doing very well. He's looking forward to his meeting with Kim Jong-un. The goal has to be the denuclearization of North Korea. We have made no concessions.
Welcome to the channel info box.
People.
À travers son histoire, a montré toujours sa force.
Which through their history, its history always has always shown its strength. But we do not to repeat the mistakes of the past. Each time we tried to unilaterally replace the sovereignty of a people, we've brought about some more terror. But for our allies, we want sustainable stability. And I believe that the discussions we've had together make it possible to open the way, to pave the way for a new agreement, an agreement on which we will work. And beyond our European partners, we would like to involve the regional powers, and of course, Russia and Turkey.
It is
also within this framework, as a matter of fact, that together, in the long run, we can find a solution to the Syrian situation. In Syria, we are together engaged within the international coalition against Daesh and the terrorists, and we will continue to act till the end within this framework until victory. That being said, in the long run, we need to win peace and make sure that Syria does not fall into any hegemony in the region. So to that effect, the approach which is agreed means that we can work on all of the situation, the whole of the situation in the region. And with these efforts, to contain Iran in the region. We will continue to work to that effect within the UN Security Council to make sure that humanitarian law, the prohibition of chemical weapons are fully complied with, and we will continue to shoulder our responsibilities to that effect. But we will also work with our partners in building a sustainable political solution, an inclusive one that will prevent any Germany and once again will prevent feeding terrorism in the future. We also talked about the climate, and here also we know where we stand. France will continue to work on major pieces, including the Global Compact for the Environment. But I think I can say that our economic, our businesses, our researchers can continue to work on concrete solutions in the field, and we are both attached to that. Now on trade. Like you mentioned it, and I hear what you said when you call upon fair and equitable trade. When we look at international trade today, we have some common challenges. There are some overcapacities in a number of sectors which are well known, and we shall work together to make sure that this does not destabilize our markets or brings about some unfair competition. But I believe we can say that we are both attached to make sure that between allies there is compliance with international trade law. At least France is attached to that. We have preferences. There are situations we can probably improve. But I believe that both you and I are also attached and want to make sure that our businesses, our companies can operate in a long, a sustainable and stable framework. Mr. President, I meant to mention these few points, which you commented as well. And allow me to say once again that the discussions we've had today, the ones we will have tomorrow, are fed not only by the strength of our historical bonds, but also by a sincere friendship, which I believe we share. So thank you once again, Mr. President, Madam, for this extremely warm welcome, for these 3 days spent with you. And thank you as well for being there to meet the challenges which are important for the United States of America, for France and for Europe, and important for our peoples. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
I like him a lot. First of all, I want to thank our Vice President and Karen for being here. Thank you very much. Appreciate it. We had a wonderful conference today, and I think especially the one-on-one in the Oval Office, we covered a lot of territory having to do with trade, having to do with Iran, and various other subjects. So I think a lot of good things are going to come out of our meeting. And I appreciate you being here. And we'll take a couple of questions. How about Jeff Mason from Reuters? Jeff?
Yeah, thank you, Mr. President.
Hi, Jeff.
Hi there. After your discussions today with President Macron, what is your thinking about a timeline for bringing U.S. troops out of Syria? And on one other topic, you mentioned today that you thought the leader of North Korea has behaved openly and honorably. This is someone who many people have accused of starving his people, killing family members. What did you mean when you called him that?
Well, we will start with your second part of the question, and I hope that we will be able to deal in a very open and honorable fashion with North Korea. I started a process, and when I did, everybody thought I was doing it absolutely wrong. But in the meantime, for 25 years, people have been dealing and nothing happened. And a lot's happening right now. I can tell you that, Jeff. A lot is happening. And I think it's going to be very positive. And I hope it's going to be very positive for North Korea and for South Korea and Japan and the rest of the world. But I am starting at a level that, frankly, I shouldn't have had to start. This should have been worked out a long time ago. This should have been worked out many years ago. We were discussing that. We shouldn't be having this situation happen to the United States and the world. This should have been resolved by other presidents and by other leaders of other countries a long time ago. With that being said, I think we're doing very well. Meetings are being set up, and I want to see denuclearization of North Korea. A lot of concessions have already been made. We have made no concessions, despite some of the media saying that I've made concessions. I haven't even discussed a concession, other than the fact that meeting is a great thing. And I'm sure that a lot of other people would have liked to have had the position we're having. I will say this, we put the strongest sanctions on a country that we ever have put on any country by far. China, President Xi has been very strong in helping us to solve this problem, in his case at the border. He's allowing very little to get through. I think he's doing that for a number of reasons. We have a very good relationship, and also it's very important in terms of trade, because I do play the trade card. If you look at what's happening with trade in China, it hasn't been fair for many, many years to the United States, and we're going to solve that problem. In fact, we're having Secretary Mnuchin and a couple of other folks heading over to Bob Lighthizer, heading over to China at the request of China. They came here, as you know, last week, and we're having very substantive discussions on trade. But I think it all plays to the border and the fact that they have been extremely strong on the border, and very little has gotten through, much to the surprise of a lot of people. And I believe the trade will work out, but I also think that China has never treated us with more respect than they have over the last short period of time that I'm president. I have a very excellent, as you know, relationship with President Xi, and I think that relationship is very important as to what's happening with North Korea. So the end result is we'll see. Maybe good things will happen, and maybe we're all wasting a lot of time, but hopefully it'll be good for everybody concerned. As far as Syria is concerned, I would love to get out. I'd love to bring our incredible warriors back home. They've done a great job. We've essentially just absolutely obliterated ISIS in Iraq and in Syria. And we've done a big favor to neighboring countries, frankly, but we've also done a favor for our country. With that being said, Emmanuel and myself have discussed the fact that we don't want to give Iran open season to the Mediterranean, especially since we really control it to a large extent. We really have controlled it, and we've set control on it. So we'll see what happens. But we're going to be coming home relatively soon. We've finished at least almost our work with respect to ISIS in Syria, ISIS in Iraq, and we have done a job that nobody has been able to do. But with that being said, I do want to come home, but I want to come home also with having accomplished what we have to accomplish. So we are discussing Syria as part of an overall deal. When they made the Iran deal, what they should have done is included Syria. When I say should have, before giving them Iran $150 billion and $1.8 billion in cash, $1.8 million in cash. If you think about this, before giving this kind of tremendous money, okay, $150 billion and $1.8 billion in cash, in barrels, I hear it was taken out, and in boxes it was taken out, cash. They should have made a deal that covered Yemen, that covered Syria, that covered other parts of the Middle East where Iraq is involved, where Iran is involved. They didn't do that. So we want to come home. We'll be coming home. But we want to have a very, very strong, we want to leave a strong and lasting footprint. And that was a very big part of our discussion. Okay? Thank you.
Just a follow-up, if I may, sir. On North Korea, you said you believe in complete denuclearization. What does that mean exactly?
It means they get rid of their nukes. Very simple. They get rid of their nukes, and nobody else would say it. It'd be very easy for me to make a simple deal and claim victory. I don't want to do that. I want them to get rid of their nukes.
And for President Macron, the president referred earlier in your meetings in the cabinet room to a potential deal between the two of you on Iran. Can you give us a sense of what that might be? And are you confident that you'll have assurances from President Trump that the United or that the European Union will be excluded from tariffs on steel and aluminum?
Look, as for the second question, is it a president to answer? But I just want here on the trade issue to be very clear. When you look at the trade issues between our two countries, they are balanced. There is no unbalanced relationship. Second, we are following and respecting the WTO rules, because we are the one who contributed to the creation of WTO, and we think it makes sense to respect the rule you decided to create. In life, that's a good method. Third, because I do believe that we have a very first issue on trade, which is overcapacities in steel and aluminium. It doesn't come from Europe and not even from France. And it's good to work together when you are allies, and especially when you work so closely together on security issues like Iran and Syria. So I'm confident about the future of the trade relationship, as I think it's part of a broader picture where our interests are totally aligned. As for the Iranian situation, and I think I detailed in my introduction, for me, the key pillars of this new approach we want to adopt. And it's exactly what President Trump said. We have nuclear on the short run. We have nuclear on the long run. We have ballistic activity. We have regional presence of Iran. We want to fix the situation for these four pillars. Syria is part of the fourth one. And what we have to work on, obviously, with Iran and the different parties in the region, the P5 and our allies, is to find a fair deal where we can fix the overall situation. This is the only way to preserve sovereignty in the region and to build peace on the very long run. Otherwise, we will have to come back in the region because of new terrorist groups, for sure. And I'm very happy about the discussion we had together, because we raised very, very new issues and very new solutions together. And especially the fact that the Syrian crisis and the Syrian situation should be part of this broader picture. And the fact that we are here and we are today in Syria, together as the international coalition against ISIS. But tomorrow we will have to find a way to fix the situation from a political point of view, not automatically from a military point of view, which means to set up a series of agreements, part of this big deal, in order to be sure that Syria tomorrow will be a sovereign country with inclusiveness and free people in a situation to decide for the future. This is very important, and that's our duty.
And I think we will have a great shot at doing a much bigger, maybe deal, maybe not deal. We're going to find out, but we'll know fairly soon. Mr. President?
Une question de la presse.
A question from the French press.
Bonjour.
A question from Agence France Presse on behalf of the French press. As you arrived, Mr. President, you were saying that there was no plan B, that the Iran deal was to be preserved. Now you're talking about a new deal with Iran. Why did you change your mind? Did you join the strong approach suggested by President Trump? Is it because you could not convince him? And in addition, do you think the other who signed the agreement, the deal, will follow you? When I say there is no plan B, I usually refer to the fact that there is no B planet. It was about climate rather than Iran. Rather, now, regarding Iran, I've always been coherent, and you can go back to what I said at the UN General Assembly in September. I always said that there was the JCPOA, but we needed to add three pillars: post-2025, the ballistic issue, and the regional influence. I do not know what President Trump will decide regarding the JCPOA, and it is his responsibility. The JCPOA is the first pillar of this framework I just described. So I'm not saying that we're moving from one deal to another. I'm saying it is one aspect of the problem. I've never been as critical of the JCPOA as President Trump has, because I believe that we can usefully add to it. But no matter the decision that President Trump will take, I would like us to work as from now on a due deal with four pillars, including what is already covered by the JCPOA, that is ongoing nuclear, the current nuclear activities, the long-run nuclear activities, the ballistic activities, and the regional influence. So this is constant. But over the past few weeks, and in particular today, we've been able to go and to very much talk in details about this topic, including the situation in the region. And I believe that we've converged on a common reading of what is happening in Syria, in Yemen, in Iraq in particular, and on the fact that the nuclear issue is not the only one, that indeed there is a problem with the ballistical activity of Iran and their presence in a number of countries in the region, and that our willingness was indeed to set the conditions for the stability of the region. Once we've built this convergence of view, the idea of moving on to a new deal that would include the solution for Syria, I believe, is a strong step forward thanks to the discussions we've had today. So I very much would like us to work together with all of our partners. And the ministers of foreign affairs already gathered the small group, and they will be doing it again anytime soon. The purpose is to have some
the vote counts if it isn't the deciding vote. So it was actually 11-9 with, I believe, an extent. There was one vote. What would you call that, John?
A present vote.
Not present.
No, present.
Oh, it's called present. Okay. So.